Joining us as we count it down, less than 5 minutes now until liftoff, NBC News senior correspondent Tom Costello, Major General Charles Bolden, former astronaut and NASA administrator, and the Franklin Institute chief astronomer Derrick Pitt. So great to have all of you with us for this very special moment. Tom, as we await the moment of liftoff, walk us through what we're about to see.
Well, this is a critical test flight for Boeing. As you mentioned, this will be the third attempt in just the last 2 months or so to put humans on this Boeing Starliner spaceship. NASA has always said they need more than one way to get a crew to the International Space Station. Right now, they're completely reliant on SpaceX. Boeing is years behind schedule in getting Starliner ready to go. Now, they have successfully gotten an uncrewed mission already to the space station, but now we have two astronauts on board, and their lives are on the line. To be candid, we have Butch Wilmore and Sonny Williams, two NASA veterans, two Navy test pilots, and they are about to ride this, as we just heard Butch say a moment ago, let's put some fire on this rocket and push it into space. So they are ready to go. All eyes are on this mission because not only is it high stakes, it is also critical for Boeing, which, as you know, has had a troubled few years from in all of its divisions, not only commercial airliners, but its space program. And now we are about a minute and a half away from a critical test.
And so we see they are ready to go. We heard it's a go for launch. Again, moments from now, we'll see this rocket lift off. General, the two astronauts, they're calling Sonny and Butch on board, our former Navy test pilots. What kind of prep goes into a launch like this? And talk about the sense of anticipation these two are likely experiencing.
Well, there's a lot of prep that goes into it. Sonny and Butch, for example, have been training for probably more than 2 years on this particular vehicle, learning every procedure possible. Every time they go into the simulator, it's like disaster training because they want to make sure that if anything happens, the crew can react appropriately. Equally, the ground crew has been through lots of training. They go through malfunction training also so that they can respond when anything happens, as we had happened last week with the ground launch sequencer.
Yeah, last week when they had to scrap, didn't ever hit the go button, but they called it off within minutes. Let's just listen in now that we're less than a minute away from launch time.
30. Centaur at plate press. 25.
Status check.
Go Atlas.
Go Centaur.
Go Starliner. Godspeed, Butch and Sonny.
Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. Ignition. Liftoff of Starliner at Atlas V, carrying two American heroes, drawing a line to the stars for all of us.
Commander Butch Wilmer there, calling down to Mission Control here in Houston that the spacecraft has begun rolling into the right attitude for its ascent, and the guidance, navigation, and control officer here in the room seeing good data on that.
Got a good throttle up.
Starliner and Atlas. Looking good with speeds and attitude increasing as expected. Coming up in less than 20 seconds, the solid rocket boosters will run out of fuel and burn out.
Good SRB burnout.
Good SRB. Now that the fuel in the solid rocket boosters has been depleted, the Atlas main booster stage will be continuing its burn for about the next 3 minutes.
Good handle. Good handle.
That call, good handle from Capcom Joshua Kutrick, indicating that the crew now has the ability to initiate an abort manually if needed. All looking good so far. Now 2 minutes into Starliner's flight and coming up on the solid rocket booster jettison at the 2 minute and 40 second mark.
We're going to keep watching this, and we'll listen back in as they speak more. But there's this
little good trajectory.
Sounds like so far, Derrick, everything is going as planned.
The solid rocket boosters have now been jettisoned after seeing Starliner through its first 90 seconds of flight. Team on the ground here confirming that it was a good jettison and that the vehicle's trajectory continues to look good. Now 3 minutes into today's flight.
Derrick, your thoughts as we watch this moment and what appears to be everything going as planned right now?
I'm sure everyone is excited and satisfied at what they've seen so far in this first 2 minutes of flight of the Atlas Centaur rocket and the Starliner capsule. I'm sure that the astronauts on board are feeling good about this as they see everything is looking as its nominal flight. And the excitement of this should be palpable by everyone involved in this as the spacecraft makes its way up to International Space Station. This is a great day so far for Boeing, and I'm sure everybody's happy about the progress so far.
General, talk to us about how long this whole process takes, this what is considered kind of launch process from lifting off until they are in orbit, I guess.
Well, the crew's been following along with everything there. As you probably heard a little bit ago, they got to a point where they could actually execute a manual separation and manual abort if something became necessary. But right now, they're observing all the parameters on board, making sure everything's going well. A big difference between the Boeing spacecraft that we're on today and, say, the SpaceX Crew Dragon is that this vehicle is built to be piloted. So it has a lot of manual interaction that's possible. In fact, once they separate on the way to the station tomorrow, they'll do a number of manual maneuvers just to make sure that the vehicle can be controlled by the crew. And I'm not absolutely certain, but they'll probably do a manual docking the way that we used to do in the shuttle.
And what are the astronauts experiencing right now, General? We know that they were just discussing the G-forces.
You know, it's interesting. Never having been on anything except the space shuttle, on the shuttle at liftoff, you felt about a G and a half. Believe it or not, it's not a lot. It's like being with your teenage kid in a car at a stoplight, and the light changes green, and they all of a sudden floor it, and you get pushed back in your seat a little bit. And so that's about it. The maximum amount of G that they feel is around 3 or 4 Gs, and it's actually through your chest as you get to the point where all the boosters, and in this particular case, when the primary launch vehicle, the Atlas V, when it gets ready to separate, they're going to feel a pressure across their chest that I used to describe it as like having a gorilla sit on your chest. And then once the separation from the Atlas V occurs, everything will really settle down. They'll be on the Centaur and its two engines until they get to the point where the Centaur finally finishes. And by the depiction there on the screen, it looks like they've already separated from the primary launch vehicle, the Atlas V, and they're now going on the two Centaur engines.
Derrick, what's your perspective on just how important this mission is?
Well, this mission really is important because NASA really needs to have more than one spacecraft to shuttle astronauts from Earth up to International Space Station. And this builds their capability in moving forward for the Artemis program, which will then be taking astronauts out to the moon. So all of these steps give us greater capability, give NASA greater capability, greater flexibility, and the ability to have redundancy in spacecraft that carry astronauts from Earth up to space station. So this craft, along with the SpaceX spacecraft, gives NASA a lot of flexibility in that there are two different kinds of spacecraft. They operate differently, but they can do the same job very, very well. And that allows NASA to have some room to begin to build additional capability on as we build into the Artemis program heading out to the moon.
General, of course, SpaceX has already been flying missions with astronauts for years. Why is SpaceX so far ahead?
Well, the primary reason that SpaceX is so far ahead, Ana, is that Boeing, on their initial flight, actually suffered some software problems and other issues that caused them to overuse the propellant. And so they were unable to get into a safe orbit that would have taken them to the International Space Station. That set them back significantly. And then they've had a number of other maybe quality issues, and it's taken them these. So they're now 4 years behind SpaceX. But I think, you know, once now that they've gotten this flight off, I agree with Derrick. This was a critical mission, not just for NASA, but for Boeing to demonstrate, to give them some confidence, to demonstrate that they have the capability to do this. We're far from complete. I mean, we've got to get off the Centaur, do some tests on the CST-100 over the next day, and then tomorrow, hopefully we'll have a perfect docking. They'll spend 8 days on the International Space Station, and then they'll undock and then come home. The ultimate test is how does the spacecraft handle the intense heat and pressure of reentry, and then is the landing out in the desert, does it go the way we want it to go? Only once they've touched down out in the desert 10 days from now or 8 days from now, will we be able to take our breath and say we've had a successful flight.